Let us see about the prostate gland. So I want to show you the prostate gland here in the male satchel section of the pelvis. You can see this is the male satchel section. So here this is the pubic symphysis. Here behind you can see the sacrum here, and between the pubic symphysis and the sacrum we have the urinary bladder. Again, this is the rectum, this is the ampulla of the rectum. So just below the bladder you can see this is the prostate gland. This is the prostate gland. So the prostate gland is an accessory gland of the male reproductive system, and it secretions, mainly it adds bulk to the semen, and it is very firm. If you feel this, if it's very hard because of the fibromuscular connective tissue present in the prostate gland, and this is present behind the pubic symphysis. This is the pubic symphysis, or the body of the pubis behind the pubic symphysis, and in front of the rectum or ampulla of the rectum, and below the bladder, that is below the neck of the bladder, and above the urogenital diaphragm. It lies on the urogenital diaphragm. This is the urogenital diaphragm starting from here, lower part of the pubic symphysis. So this is the location of the prostate gland, and it is an inverted cone shaped structure. This is the base above, and it has an apex. So this is inverted cone, and if you observe the gross features of the prostate gland, it is having an apex downward. So this is an apex and this is base, and it is having an anterior surface. This one is anterior surface and this is posterior surface, and on either side you have the inferolateral surfaces. You can see this is the inferolateral surface. So you have three surfaces for the prostate gland. And coming to the apex, so the apex lies on the urogenital diaphragm. Urogenital diaphragm, you could see urogenital diaphragm is nothing but you have formed by the deep transperineal muscle and the sphincter urethrae, and it is covered by the superior fascia of urogenital diaphragm and inferior fascia of urogenital diaphragm. So this, over this lies the apex of the urinary prostate gland. See, the content of the urogenital diaphragm is the opening of the urethra also. You can see the opening here of the urethra. See, this is the through the internal urethral orifice, if I pass it through, it will reach the here like this. So this is the apex lies at the urogenital diaphragm. And coming to the base here, if you observe the base is continuous with the neck of the bladder. See, this is the bladder, this is the neck of the bladder. And we have a groove between the bladder, neck of the bladder and the prostate. So around this groove, we have the prostatic venous plexus lies. You can see here, this is the prostatic vesical venous plexus. Deep to that is the prostatic venous plexus. Here. So this is about the base. And coming to the surfaces, we have anterior surface here. So this anterior surface is having attachment with the pubis with the ligaments. This is a medial puboprostatic ligaments. You can see this is a medial puboprostatic ligament. And further laterally, you have lateral puboprostatic ligament that is attached to the base actually. But to the anterior surface is a medial puboprostatic ligament. This is nothing but the condensation of pelvic fascia only. Right. And if you observe the near to the lower border or lower part of the anterior surface, we have an opening of the urethra. Near to the apex or near to the lower end of the anterior surface, we have an opening of the urethra. And coming to the posterior surface, you can see this is the posterior surface. It is connected with the or separated from the rectum, ampulla of the rectum. You can see this is the rectum. So behind the posterior surface is separated from the rectum by a fascia that is called as the fascia of Dinon Milius. You can see this is the fascia of Dinon Milius. And not only that, ejaculatory ducts will be opening. So ejaculatory ducts open from the posterior surface into the urethra. So if even here also, if I pass a probe here, it reaches the urethra from the posterior surface. You know that ejaculator opens into the urethra only. See here. So it opens into the urethra like this way. So posterior surface is pierced by the ejaculatory duct also. And coming to the lateral surface, inferior lateral surface, it is connected with the, you can see this muscle, this is the levator ani muscle. So the levator ani muscle and fascia covering levator ani, they form the relation with the inferior lateral surface. Not only that, we have the venous plex, prostatic venous plexus also form a lateral relation for the prostate gland. And it is having 5 lobes. So it is having anterior lobe and posterior lobe and median lobe in the center and 2 lateral lobes on either side. So the anterior lobe, this one is the anterior lobe, it connects the 2 lateral lobes, this one of the right side and left side. The 2 lateral lobes are connected by the anterior lobe. Same way the posterior lobe is present here, that also connects the 2 lateral lobes acting as an isthmus. Whereas in the median lobe is present between the anterior lobe and the posterior lobe. So between the, what is the demarcation between the anterior and median lobe is, between the anterior lobe and the median lobe, we have a passage here, that is the urethra will be passing. Urethra will be passing here, like this way you could see, right. So this is the demarcation. So urethra, in front of the urethra is the anterior lobe, behind it is the median lobe. So same way, if you observe, you can see I have passed a probe from the ejaculatory duct. So behind the median lobe and in front of the posterior lobe is the opening of the ejaculatory duct. Ejaculatory duct, it enters the posterior surface and by piercing the median lobe, it enters into the urethra. So the crossing of the ejaculatory duct passes through the median lobe and enters into the urethra. So the ejaculatory duct forms present between the median lobe and the posterior lobe. So now this becomes the anterior lobe, which is in front of the passage of the urethra, and this becomes the median lobe, which is present in between the urethra opening and the ejaculatory duct, and behind this is the posterior lobe. And median lobe is mainly, it is for the benign hypertrophy is more common in the median lobe, whereas carcinoma is more common in the posterior lobe. So these are the lobes of the prostate gland. And if you take the interior of the prostate gland, it is having the central zone and the peripheral zone. And whereas central zone is 25%, peripheral zone is 75%. Peripheral zone is having prostatic glands, full of prostatic glands, whereas central zone is having submucosal glands. But both these two glands will be opening into the prostatic sinus, which is present in the prostatic urethra or the prostatic crest present in the urethra. So we have 2 zones are there, and dependingly we have the peripheral zone is more common prone for the carcinoma, whereas the central zone is more prone for benign hypertrophy. And coming to the ligaments of the prostate gland, we have ligaments are, you can see this is the anteriorly pubo-prostatic ligament. This is the medial pubo-prostatic ligaments. It is a condensation of the fibrous pelvic fascia. And prostate gland is covered by the 2 capsules. One is true capsule and false capsule. True capsule is nothing but the condensation of fibrous stroma of the gland itself. Whereas false capsule is nothing but the condensation of pelvic fascia. So between the true and false capsule, we have the prostatic venous plexus. You can see this venous plexus, if I am removing it, above this is a false capsule, pelvic fascia, and deep to that is a true capsule. So this is about the true and false capsules of the prostate gland. And coming to the blood supply of this, blood supply is by the inferior vesical artery. You don't have particular arteries, but the arteries which supplies the nearby organs, that is to the bladder is the inferior vesical artery, to the rectum is the middle rectal artery. So inferior vesical artery, middle rectal artery and internal pudendal artery will be supplying the prostate gland. Venous drainage is the veins drains into the prostatic venous plexus, whereas nerve supply is by the sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers. Lymphatic drainage is into the nearby lymph node, that is internal iliac lymph nodes and external iliac lymph nodes. And coming to the importance of this gland is age changes, that is at the time of birth it is very small, it is only consists of the stroma, whereas the till puberty it grows in size. From puberty onwards, that is from 14 to 20 years, it becomes increases in size, even with the glandular tissue also. And between 20 to 30 years, it proliferates, proliferation of the gland will be taking place. After 30 years till 45 years, you'll have the size will be normal, constant, but involution starts. And after 40-45 years, it will have full of amyloid bodies will be seen, and even the constant growth will be seen. After 50-60 years, like it is having involution, as I was telling, and senile atrophy also may be common, that is due to age changes. And at this age, what happens is sometimes we have benign hypertrophy may happen, that is to the median lobe. So where there is growth of the cells present in the median lobe, it have an increase in number of the cells, then it will have the hypertrophy, and then it constricts the urethra in front of the median lobe. As you know, this is having urethra, so it constricts the urethra, there is painful urination will be there because of the benign hypertrophy. This term we call it as a BPH, benign prostatic hypertrophy, is more common after 55 years of the age of the males. So this is about the prostate gland.